Okay, so this is the last topic for the cardiovascular system. So the exam for this lecture will be taken from the Byrne and Levy. So it is chapter 9 of the 16th edition. So there are four factors that control the cardiac output. So these are your heart rate, the preload, the myocardial contractility, and the afterload. So your preload is the, we call it the end diastolic volume or the end diastolic of the right and end diastolic volume of the left. And the afterload is the pressure on the wall of the left ventricle during ejection or at the end of the load against which the heart contracts to eject the blood. So these are the factors that mutually dependent on the behavior of the heart rate and the vasculature. So there are the important determinants of the cardiac output and are themselves determined by the cardiac output. So these factors are, we call it the coupling factors. So next is your cardiac function curve. So I already discussed your cardiac cycle. So it is the expression of the well-known Frank-Starling relationship. And it illustrates the dependence of cardiac output on preload. Example, your central venous pressure, your right atrial pressure, which is dependent on your superior vena cava and the inferior vena cava pressure. And also, this is dependent on the characteristic of the cardiac itself, no, the cardiac muscle or the myocardium. Okay, so these are the vascular function curve, which is dependent on the central venous pressure on the cardiac output. And it is dependent on the peripheral vascular resistance, the arterial and the venous compliances, and also the blood volume. And it is independent of the characteristic of the heart. So the cardiac output is independent, variable, or stimulus. So it can change, no, depending on the peripheral vascular resistance, your arterial venous compliances, and also the blood volume. So this formula shows the compliance of the system, which is subdivided into the arterial compliance and the venous compliance. So the compliance of the blood vessel is the change in the volume, which is this one, and that is accommodated in the vessel per unit change in the transmural pressure. So your compliance is dependent on the change in compliance of your blood vessel and also the pressure. So it is volume divided by the change in pressure. So the venous compliance is about 20 times greater than the arterial compliance, and the ratio is set to 19, no, is to 1. So the pressure in the venous is greater than the arterial, which is the normal ratio is 19 is to 1. So in this figure, so this is the simplified model of the cardiovascular system, which is consistent of a pump, arterial compliance, peripheral resistance, and the venous compliance. So there are different factors that influence the vascular function curve. So it is dependent on the blood volume, the venomotor tone, the blood reservoir, the peripheral resistance, and the interrelationship between the cardiac output and the venous return. So in this graph, you will note that the volume is directly proportional to the cardiac output. So the vascular function curve is affected by variation in the total volume. So during the circulatory standstill, which means that the cardiac output is zero, the mean circulatory pressure depends only on total vascular compliance and blood volume. So for a given vascular compliance, the mean circulatory pressure is increased when the blood volume is expanded. So it means that if the volume is hypervolemia, which means that the volume is high, and and is decreased when the blood volume is diminished. So the as your volume is directly proportional to your cardiac output. So it means that if there is a high pressure, a high volume also, there will be high cardiac output, no? So the next pressure, the next factor that can affect the vascular function is your venomotor. So the venomotor, So this affects the increased blood volume and the decrease in blood volume curve. So you will note that the if there's a transfusion, so the cardiac output is also high. And if there is a hemorrhage or if there is a bleeding, the cardiac output is also low. So the similar shifts in the vascular function curve can be produced by increase and decreases in the venomotor tone. So that affects the changes in the venomotor tone on the vascular function curve that closely resemble those for the change in the volume. So the transfusion curve could also represent an increase in venomotor curve, whereas hemorrhage curve could represent the decrease in tone. So during the circulatory standstill, as I said, the higher the blood volume, the higher the cardiac output. So the next is the blood reservoir. So in humans, the volume changes in the spleen are considerably less extensive. So there are different blood reservoirs, no? The skin, the liver, the lungs, and the spleen. So the skin vascular bed, which is the major blood reservoir in human, wherein they're undergo subcutaneous vasoconstriction, and several hundreds of ml of blood freed for each for the more vital organ. So it is important reservoir, no, of blood. It's also the liver, the lungs, and the spleen. However, the spleen is less extensive, no, in humans compared to other organisms. So the interrelationship between the cardiac output and the venous return. So the heart cannot pump more blood than what is being delivered to it by the venous system. So the cardiac output is very dependent on the venous return. So example, your superior vena cava and your inferior vena cava, if the volume being given to the heart is less, so this that is the only volume that the heart can pump. Example, if they can give only 5 liters of blood, they can only pump 5 liters of blood, no? So the heart is very dependent on the venous return. And also, it is a closed circuit. So the flow around the entire circuit depends on the capability of the pump, the characteristic of the circuit, and the total fluid of the system. So if there's a problem in the pump, which is the heart, so there will be a problem in the vascular function curve and also cardiac output. So if there's a problem in the total fluid, there will be also a problem in the cardiac output. So it is directly proportional, no? So it is directly related to each other. So this curve is the enhancement of the myocardial contractility, which is stimulated by the sympathetic nerve stimulation that causes the equilibrium values of the cardiac output and the central venous pressure to shift from the intersection of the controlled vascular and the cardiac function curve to the intersection. So you will note, no, as I said last week, that your sympathetic stimulation is balanced by your parasympathetic. So if you have a problem in the contractility, so the one that will help to increase the heart rate, the blood pressure, is the sympathetic. But if the patient is healthy, the one that controls the heart rate and the cardiac output are the parasympathetic. So This curve shows that the change in blood volume do not directly affect the myocardial contractility. So it means that even the volume in the heart is increased, the contractility remains the same, no? So it is not affected by the contractility is independent with the blood volume. So in this curve, so this is another example, no, of the control of your blood volume to the cardiac output and the CBP. So as I said a while ago, if there's a hemorrhage, there is a lower CBP and also lower cardiac output. And after transfusion, the CBP and the cardiac output also increases. So if there's a heart failure, this is the impaired pumping capability of the heart, the tissues of the body not adequately perfused, and the myocardial contractility is impaired. So the different organs of our body is very dependent, no, on the cardiac output that is being produced by the heart. So if the patient produce or have a heart failure, so the tissues of the body will also be affected. The most commonly affected are the kidneys, the liver, and also the spleen. No, the patient can have acute renal failure or liver failure. No, once the heart have a defect. No, because the heart is the one that will distribute the blood volume in different parts of the body, and also for the different organs of the body to be well perfused, it should have a good myocardial contractility. So for patient with heart failure, the myocardial contractility is also impaired. So for acute heart failure, so usually it is caused by the toxic concentration of the drugs, especially in patient who uses methamphetamine, no? The ones that are being affected are the contractility of the, or we call it the ejection fraction of the heart. So usually those drug users will have a, we call it the dilated cardiomyopathy. Another example of acute heart failure is the coronary artery occlusion, or if the patient have acute coronary syndrome, or more commonly known as myocardial infarction. And as I said, the blood volume does not change, no, immediately, but eventually the patient will have anemia because of the increase in the VO2, no, consumption of the heart because of the heart failure. So the chronic heart failure, it is secondary usually to essential hypertension, ischemic heart disease, increase in blood volume, which is caused by the fluid retention, no, especially in patient with acute renal failure. Fluid retention is related to concomitant reduction in GFR, and also decrease in renal excretion of the sodium and water. So usually the patient with chronic heart failure are edematous, no? And also they have decrease in urine output, and eventually they will develop coronary kidney disease. So in this diagram, you will note that the moderate to severe heart failure shifts the cardiac function curves downward and to the right. So before changes in blood volume, the cardiac output decreases and the central venous pressure rises. So this is the point A to point B or point C. So after the increase in blood volume that usually occurs in heart failure, the vascular function curve is shifted to the right. Hence, the CBP or the central venous pressure may be elevated with no reduction in the cardiac output, or with some reduction in the cardiac output, which is from the point C. Sometimes, if there's an increase in volume, the cardiac output initially will not be affected, but eventually, if there's a serious heart failure or chronic heart failure, the reduction in cardiac output will also be affected. So in this graph, you will note an increase in the peripheral resistance shifts the cardiac and the vascular function curves downward. At equilibrium, cardiac output is less when peripheral resistance is high than when it is normal. So the central venous pressure and the cardiac output are usually inversely proportional, no? Okay, next. So this is the, we call it, so the cardiovascular system has two pumps, which is in series, no? We have the pulmonary part and the systemic part, no? So the series arrangement requires that the flow pump by the two ventricles be virtually equal to each other over any substantial period. Otherwise, all the blood will ultimately accumulate in one or other of the vascular system. Because the cardiac function curves of the two ventricles differ substantially, the filling pressure for the two ventricles must differ appropriately to ensure the equal stroke volume. So there are two basic principles for ventricular function. No? The left ventricular pumps blood through the systemic vasculature, and the right ventricular pumps that pump blood through the pulmonary vasculature. So if there is a left ventricular failure, this is a change in the contractility that affects the two ventricles, differently alters the distribution of blood volume in the two vascular system. And the left ventricle becomes occluded, then the left ventricular contractility is also impaired. And if there is a right ventricular heart failure, so usually, no, this is caused by the occlusive disease that predominantly of the coronary vessels of the right ventricles, or sometimes major hemodynamic effects that causes reduction in cardiac output and arterial pressure. So the treatment will be infusion of blood and bypass of the right ventricle. So the role of the heart rate in the control of the cardiac output. So as we know, the cardiac output is equals to stroke volume times the heart rate. So change in heart rate alters three factors, no? As I said in the beginning of the lecture. So this is dependent on the preload, the afterload, and the contractility. These are the factors that determine the stroke volume. So an increase in heart rate shortens the duration of diastole, so it causes a diminish in ventricular filling, and also preload is decreased. So increase in heart rate altered the cardiac output, change in arterial pressure, altered afterload, increased influx of the calcium per minute into the myocardial cell, and enhance the myocardial contractility. So bradycardia, this is the slowing, no, of the sinus rhythm, which is common in patients with sick sinus syndrome and in patient with endoventricular rhythm, which is secondary to complete AV block. So complete AV block is the most common cause of common cause of bradycardia, no, especially in patient with problem in the conduction of the system of the heart. So next is supraventricular tachycardias are secondary to the AB, say, SA node problem, no? So this happens when this causes the critically low cardiac output, and it causes a restricted filling time at a very high rate. So usually the treatment will be cardioversion. So the circulatory effects of the respiratory system. So in this diagram, during a normal inspiration, the intrathoracic and the right atrial pressure and the JVP, which is the jugular venous pressure, decreases and the flow in the superior vena cava increases. So from 5.2, it becomes 11. So all pressures are in millimeter mercury and the femoral arterial pressure did not change substantially during the normal inspiration. However, in this diagram, the only shown is the jugular venous pressure. So the femoral artery is not affected by the respiratory activity. So next is the cardiac output. So your cardiac output will increase, no, during sympathetic drive and decreases during the parasympathetic inhibition of your SA node during exercise. So if there's a problem between the sympathetic and the parasympathetic, there will be persistent tachycardia. So there will be a increase in workload and it will remain during the period of exercise. And increase in workload will increase the heart rate until a plateau of 180 beats per minute is reached during the strenuous activity. So in a healthy adult, they usually have increase in heart rate. But if the patient have a problem in the SA node, they usually, example, if the patient have complete heart block, no, even they exercise, they will not have an increase in heart rate. So next is hemorrhage. This is the large quantity of blood, which is loss of blood, no, large quantity of blood which is lost, and it will cause a decrease in arterial systolic, diastolic, and blood pressure. So usually this patient will have hypotension. So the shock that we call for patient with hemorrhage is we call it a hypovolemic shock, wherein there's a collapsed vein. So most usually the patient will become pale, no, they are usually cyanotic, and they usually have tachypnea. So I think this was already discussed, no, in our previous lecture, no, the baroreceptor reflexes, the chemoreceptor reflexes, the cerebral ischemia reflexes, and the reabsorption of tissue fluids. So there are other endogenous vasoconstrictor substances, no, the epinephrine, the norepinephrine, which is also affected by your acetylcholine, and also the renal conservation of fluid and water. So patient usually have water retention, no, they will have the they will also develop edema. So most commonly for patient with heart failure, the most common treatment aside from your inotropes are your furosemide, no, for because of the renal conservation, which is the most common cause of fluid retention. So I think that's all for the integrated. I will just post the recorded lecture. So Raj, are you here? Please inform your classmate that I will be posting the lecture, and they need to sign the attendance first, then they can view the lecture, okay? So make sure that they view the lecture. So you, for your, I think the next activity will be exam.
Yes, ma'am.
When is your exam?
December 1.